wonderful you. It had to be you.
We're starting a bit late, but we got caught up talking about courses, didn't we, Michael? No. Well, there's fascinating stories of corsets. We should really explore that. There's some corsets over there, well, the designs of them, and you know, the corsets were made for every shape, and we were talking about how some women removed a couple of ribs so they had the shape properly, the nice curves. It was quite extreme corsetry. Don't see much of that anymore, or maybe we do, we just don't know. Welcome to a night at the John Oxley Library. When I told my wife we were talking about fashion, she went a bit pale because she knows that my first job interview, I wore a cream safari suit back in the 1981. No, I didn't. No, I shan't. But I was a country boy, and I flew into Sydney, actually. I walked down the street, and there's cars were stopping. I thought, what's going on? I must look really flash. But I do know a bit about fashion because I write historical novels, and to, you know, write the novel, you really do have to know the fashions of the time. Not necessarily to mention them, but to stop embarrassing yourself by mentioning something that's not in context. So, and to recreate the period, really, you need to get everything right, and that's important. And recently reading some a description of fashion from a diary from the Roth family, who described coming to Brisbane in 1903 and being amazed by the people walking down the street wearing these enormous hats in the early 1900s, and they called them mushroom hats. And there are some photographs over there of them as well. That sort of trend lasted for maybe a decade or so, but seemed to have died out. So there was adaption of fashions. We think of Brisbane, Queensland still being stuck in the British, you know, with the British way of life and the British way of dressing. But there was some innovation back then to adjust to the climate. But then I also did some research of Townsville back in 1900, and men were still wearing suits, ties, coats in summer. Must have been extremely uncomfortable. So we did need to adapt or perish, really. Anyway, we'll talk a bit more about Queensland fashions, but I think the way that fashions did change and the innovators who helped are really interesting, especially in Queensland. There's been a lot of innovation. We have Michael Marendy, the Senior Conservator of Textiles at the Queensland Museum, and Clare Collyer, who studied graphic design and fashion design and worked for a fashion label in Brisbane, but is now, I suppose, an innovator, and that she's changed with the times and applied her skills to ropes. We'll talk about that a bit later. Clare, before we go too far back into the past, you told me that one particular designer, Gwen Gillam, who you worked on an exhibition with Michael on Gwen Gillam, had a particular impact on you. This is a woman who grew up in the 1930s and became well established as a designer in the 50s and 60s, which really her career spanned a pretty astonishing range of fashion styles. When you think, don't you, of the 40s, 50s and 60s, you can see each particular decade had a particular look. And when I look back at the 60s, 70s, 80s, every decade had a particular look, but I don't think that happens anymore. But so they're all distinctive eras of fashion that we used to have. Things have changed, haven't they, Claire?
Yes, I guess they have. But so to do with the Gwen Gillam exhibit that I designed my final year collection at TAFE around Gwen's works, and I was influenced but put a contemporary twist on them. So it was that, I focused sort of on the 50s designs and, made my final collection with those, and then they were in there.
What was appealing about the 50s designs? What did you like about them?
I don't know, I guess I like the shapes, as you can tell what I'm wearing. And I loved all the lines of Gwen's dresses that she did.
That's 50s design? Is that a 50s style?
Well, it's the classic shape of the fitted bodice and the poofy skirt. Right. Yeah.
And we had Gwen, and then we had Paula Stafford on the Gold Coast. We'll talk a bit about Paula a bit later. Is there a genealogy of fashion in Queensland? Can you trace designers back, do you think, by the people who came before them, who might have inspired them? You mentioned Gwen. You know, would Gwen have looked back? I mean, is there a lineage?
Well, definitely, yeah. We all get inspiration from what's around us and what's come before. So it's definitely, you can trace them all back to, right back to the very beginning.
Because fashion is innovation, isn't it? It's taking something often from the past. And that's what we're doing today. We see a lot of 50s and 60s fashions coming back a bit. Michael, is there a lineage, do you think, that can be traced back?
Well, I think through my research in Queensland, I think there is. What I found when I was researching the very early Queensland designers is that they were very innovative, and a couple of them especially, they did quite special things to keep their name going for 40 years, some of them.
Who was that?
There was a woman by the name of Janet Walker. I mean, she's like my grandmother, I suppose, now.
Well, you know her so well.
Yeah, and, you know, I think there's not one day passes that she's not in a conversation. It's just amazing.
Well, tell me a bit about Janet Walker, because she is well known in fashion circles. She was quite significant in Queensland history. Tell me a little bit about who she was.
Well, she was a Scottish woman. She came out with her whole family, her mum and dad and the children all came out on a sailing ship in the 1860s, and they settled at Kangaroo Point. And her dad was a librarian, so he felt education was really important, and he shipped all the children off to the girls' normal school and the boys' normal school, which were the schools that were in Adelaide Street. And they were based on the Irish curriculum. That's why they were called normal schools.
We digress.
But anyway, Janet was a very bright girl, and she ended up becoming an assistant teacher and was promoted very quickly and made the headmistress of the West End Girls for Schools and the West End School for Girls. And it's really interesting. Just recently I found a reference to Janet and this connection to West End. In 1924, they gave out all these honours in Queensland, and they declared Janet Walker a pioneer of Queensland. But the award didn't go to her for this amazing business that she ran in Adelaide Street for, you know, 55 years, basically, she ran this business. It was given to her because she was the first headmistress of West End School for Girls, which I got very angry about.
Well, does that say something about fashion and how it's recognised in Queensland history?
Because back then, you know, they weren't called fashion designers. The word designer was not part of the vocabulary in the fashion industry. It wasn't even called the fashion industry back then either. There was a whole hierarchy of dressmakers, basically. And the top dressmaker was known as a high-class costumier. And usually costumiers would also make theatre costumes, but it wasn't their prime sort of function. And Janet Walker was probably the first woman to give herself that title. You didn't have to sort of sit for any exams or be registered with anybody. You just got to a time in your career where you felt you were good enough to take on that title, and then you just charged more. So she was a high class costumier by the time she retired at the age of 89, she retired from her shop in Queen Street. There were several other high class costumiers, but when you read the small amount of coverage that the lady journalists gave these women, I don't think they were they weren't of the caliber of Janet Walker, but they just put on this titled, I think, to be a bit snobby. So below that, you got the costumiers, and then you got the high-class dressmakers, you got the dressmakers, you had seamstresses, You had shirt hands that, you know, worked on piecework. And, of course, there was a whole apprentice system as well, because back then you actually had to do an apprenticeship to become a dressmaker or a designer, as they later, you know, were known as. It was quite interesting because you were an apprentice, and you were given the title of an improver, which was sort of slightly higher than an apprentice. And then eventually you were, you know, after 4 years, you were designated as a dressmaker. But you weren't trained in all aspects of dressmaking, which is really interesting, because when you go to TAFE today, you learn pattern making and you learn how to put the garments together and you learn how to draw and you learn about textiles and, you know, fashion forecasting, and you put all this inspiration together and you design your ranges, and the students at Mount Gravatt still have to make their own ranges. But back then, you were trained either to be a skirt hand, which meant you only made skirts. You were trained to be a sleeve hand, which meant you only inserted sleeves. Or a bodice hand, which meant you only made the bodices. Or you became an embellisher, which meant you did all the beading, because garments during the latter part of the 19th century were heavily embellished, and certainly in Janet Walker's rooms, there were beaders. And she actually, one of her innovations was when the Brisbane Technical College started its what was known as art needlework, not traditional embroidery, but it was art needlework, and it was a sort of a movement that was going on in England at that time, and they decided they would start that syllabus in Brisbane. Janet Walker sent her two best girls to the TAFE College, paid for all the classes, and they were trained in art needlework, and then they took command of the embroidery section of the workroom, and I'd say also the beading, and they did. We have one dress in the Queensland Museum which has been, it's a pineapple fibre wedding gown, and it's got the most amazing embroidery on it, and I'm sure Margaret Whittacombe, who was one of the girls that Janet sent to the Tech College, did this, you know, did the embroidery on this dress.
So that degree of specialisation was very important, and it would have made for some very high quality dresses that we might not have seen since, that sort of quality.
Yeah, I want to add one more thing for the poor old male, because the other job that was available in the workroom was to look after the irons, because they used cast irons back then. And in the Adelaide Street workrooms, Janet had a really large wood stove roaring, and it was the job of this mere male who was employed by her to put all the irons on, you know, light the stove early in the morning, get it hot, put all the irons on there ready for the girls to do all the pressing. And his other job was to go down to the docks and arrange for all the fabrics to be brought up to the workrooms. Now, when I say fabrics, not like today, again, this is another, not so much an innovation of Janet Walker, but an innovation of the sort of the dressmaking profession of that time, especially if you were in the high class calibre, you would only import dress lengths. You would not order a bolt of fabric like, you know, design rooms do today. You would only order a dress length from England, and that was made up for one client, and nobody else in Brisbane had that fabric on. And that's how you continued to be, you know, regarded as being very fashionable and very individual. And Janet Walker was a real stifler for this, and she used to go down to the Sydney and Melbourne wholesalers and come back with dress length, and she'd advertise in the Brisbane Courier what she brought back, plus all the trimmings. And then, of course, when the business was roaring, she would then do overseas trips and bring back fabrics from London, of course, French fabric. She used French fabrics quite a lot. And by the end of the 19th century, Brisbane was also importing, you know, fashion items from places like New York and also Berlin, which I found quite amazing.
Were we importing material or dresses themselves?
Both. If we want to go back to the importation, we're going to jump here, I can see
that's
that.
That's okay.
Because this is a really sort of elastic story. But if you go back to the importation of dresses, and this is something that you know, I like to tell my colleagues in Melbourne, because, you know, the Victorians all think that Brisbane was just this slum during the 19th century. But in 1865, there was a woman here by the name of Mrs. Buxton. She was a qualified dressmaker. I don't know where she trained. And she had up what they called a ladies' warehouse in Queen Street. And she was advertising to the women of Brisbane that she had signed a contract with a leading dressmaker in Paris, and she was going to start importing French fashion, French millinery, and French parasols. But she also had a dressmaking department in the warehouse, and you could have any other gown made, wedding gowns, and of course your mourning gowns, which were very important during Victorian times. And I don't mean the MORNING, but I mean the mourning as in funeral wear. And she advertised that. And she imported quite a lot of the black silks from Paris. So there was that connection that early, well, that's the earliest one I ever found, with Paris and the opportunity for Brisbane women to be wearing Parisian fashion.
So fashion was big, and we would have had fashions from England as well.
Yeah.
But how much competition was there between, well, how many Brisbane dressmakers were there back then?
Well, according to the official statistics or the census that were taken, in the mid-1880s, there were close on 900 dressmakers in the census. But through my research of, and this was before, I might add, this was before Trove, and I had to sit in the reference room downstairs and out at Fryer Library for a year trolling through the microfilms, I got the number up to over 1,000, because there were women who obviously were missed out in the census but did advertise in the papers. They were looking for staff, or they were doing so well that they would put advertisements in the Brisbane Courier or the Brisbane Telegraph.
So it sounds like it was a major industry. But I imagine as well in that period, every homemaker would have considered themselves a dressmaker as well.
Yeah, because those skills were passed from mother to daughter in the, you know, in what we'd call the sort of the working class families and the middle class families. The upper class families, the mothers did not sew. They did art needlework. That's what the wealthy women spent their leisurely time doing, because it was one of the accomplishments of being a lady during Victorian times. You played the piano, you learnt French, you learnt to sing, and you learnt art needlework, not dressmaking. And the other thing you've got to keep in mind is that there was no mass production of clothing in the early history of Brisbane. Mass production didn't come until, you know, the late 19th century, and it was really underclothes that sort of started things off. Men's shirting, there were a few shirt factories popping up around Brisbane, but not women's, you know, formal wear, wedding gowns, ball gowns, debutante dresses. You couldn't buy those off the rack.
And that, so that's where the innovation would have come and fashions would have started changing. But we will jump around a bit because, you know, my mum sewed and her mother sewed, and so my mum taught me to sew, and I'm the only person in the house who can sew, so I'm teaching my my daughters to sew. So if anything needs sewing, you know, buttons on school uniforms, I'm the one who does it. But Claire, your mum too did a lot of sewing and dressmaking.
Yeah,
is that right? So that, you know, I imagine these things are passed on, and so it's skipped it's starting to skip generations, and those skills are being lost. Mm. But you're continuing that tradition in your work.
Yeah, well, yeah, I grew up with my mum making me and my younger sister matching outfits and all sorts of interesting photos that we now are just, not too sure about. But, I've been really lucky that I had that, because I have friends who can't sew a button on, they can't take up jeans, they can't, and it's sad that those simple basic skills are being lost.
So did that proximity to art and craft in your home influence you to become a designer, do you think?
I definitely think so, yeah. We've always had a very creative childhood with my mum pushing, You know, I remember sitting down on the floor next to her sewing away with the piles of the buttons, like making pictures with all the, you know, they were my grandma's buttons and jars. I still have the jars of them. They're too precious to use. But, you know, it's that definitely having grown up with mum being so creative and...
Recycling by the sound of it too.
Clothes, yeah, clothing. Well, definitely. And my grandma was... in that era of making all her own clothes and everything, so that's got passed on to mum and now passed on to me.
We must be losing those skills hand over fist at the moment. Are we going through a period, do you think, where a lot of those skills are being lost? I know that people are taking it up and you're obviously passing it on and they're still being taught, but is it drifting away?
I think so, yeah. I mean, there's a resurgent of people wanting to, you know, create and make things and that, but I think there's also people that they just don't know how to learn those skills. It's almost too scary or too hard, and
if you don't experience it as a kid, it is a barrier, isn't it?
To walk into spotlight and buy a sewing machine, it sort of just sits on the table without, you know, how do you put that first bit of fabric under it to see if it's going to do anything. It can be scary if you've never seen someone sew on a sewing machine before, or if you don't grow up with something.
So how do you think that's influenced fashion trends? We were talking about how it was obviously there was an industry in Brisbane of dressmakers, and everybody really knew how to sew in one way or another, except for the upper class who bought their dresses. But really, most of the population would have done that. That would have influenced fashions at the time. Now you go to Kmart, I guess, and something's made in Bangladesh, perhaps.
Mass production at work there.
I mean, there's not really a particular style, I don't think. Not that I'm sort of attuned to styles, but I can't see it at the moment. There's something that's been lost, is there?
Yeah, definitely. Like that mass production, people, they don't need the skill. Like they can just, it's cheaper and easier to just go purchase something. Ready-made or mass-produced from Kmart, Target, Big W, and for them to have to take the time to learn new skills, to design something or get the pattern, read a pattern, get the fabric, cut it, try and figure it all out. You've got to have a passion to want to learn that, otherwise it's
And it almost has to be economical as well. It would be more expensive to do that than to go to a shop and actually buy something already made.
Yeah, or you can buy a dress for under, like, $20, and the fabric alone would cost more than that. So
we've lost something because of the convenience now, haven't we, Michael? What were the big revolutions in fashion? You mentioned at the end of the 1800s, and then we had mass production coming in. How did that start?
Let's go right back to my favourite date is 1675.
That's a good year.
And it's interesting because this does then tie in with what was happening in Brisbane. Because in 1678, the dressmakers of Paris finally convinced Louis XIV to give them permission to form their own guild and to be able to make garments for sale. Because up until then, the clothing industry was totally controlled by men, which is, you know, and when you look at what happened at the end of the 19th century, the industry then was being taken over by men again through mass production and also through the scientific cutting methods that were being implemented in the late 19th century. But if we go back to the French dressmakers, they were allowed to make very basic women's garments and garments for children, but only for boys up to 8 years old. It was a really interesting sort of statute. And then it wasn't until about... And they weren't allowed to make corsets. That was still in the domain of men. They weren't allowed to cut formal gowns either, like the big... You know, well, certainly in the early part of the 18th century, the women were all wearing the pannier dresses, which were quite magnificent. But they weren't allowed to cut those sort of evening gowns or wedding gowns until 1782. They must have continually pressured the government to change the statutes. And it all came to a head, I think, because there was a huge controversy in Paris where a woman had been mishandled in the fitting room while having her corset fitted by a tailor. And I think that really sparked it off, and eventually the statutes were changed. And, you know, women really didn't have any cutting skills, not great cutting skills. So when they started in 1782, if you look at the sort of fabrics that were being produced back then, they were very large, beautiful florals, lots of beautiful silks with all these magnificent florals. So that what they started to do was to cut the dresses very simply based on rectangles. And then what they would do is then pleat them in or tuck them in on the body as they needed to. But they wouldn't do that in the silk. They would always do that in the lining first. They would make up what we call today a toile. And they would pin all that out on the body, and then they would use the toile as the pattern. And then they would cut out the very, very expensive silk. And if you look at some of those dresses that have that now exist in museum collections, they must have used every single piece of that fabric, because that silk embroidered fabric was very expensive. And every bit was incorporated into the garment. But as I said, the cutting was very simple. It was basically rectangles sewn together and gathered to maybe to form the skirt. Sack dresses, which were dresses that had pleating starting from the neckline, were basically just long rectangular pieces that were all pleated in to the waist and then opened out to fit over the big petticoat. So it was very simple cutting. But of course, as we progressed through the decades, women became better and better at it. But they continued that methodology. They would, the clients would come to the workrooms. And here in Brisbane, Janet Walker would do all the fittings. She would produce the original pattern in the lining first. And then once she approved of that, it was then passed down into the workroom. And then the workroom would cut it out into the rich fabric that they were using. What happened in 1882, there was a movement called the Scientific Dress Cutting Movement, starting in London. And people think that this was an English methodology, but it wasn't. It actually came from America, because it was the male tailors in America that really developed these systems. There were some women, and I've managed to procure quite a lot of facsimiles of these old scientific drafting books. And there was a really interesting one written by a woman by the name of Elizabeth Cartland. It's probably the most comprehensive, because the problem with the books that they produced was that they didn't tell you how to do everything. Because I've tried some of these, and in my master's degree, I actually experimented with a lot of these pattern making systems. And what you had to do was you had to pay to go to the class.
So there was a licensing fee,
yes.
And that's how they made
yes.
their money. Okay.
And what happened with the dress cutting movement was that was then licensed over to England, and they set up this big institute in London in Regency Street, and then they licensed it to the rest of the colonies. And us being one of the colonies quickly grabbed it. And there were four women that I know of in Brisbane in the late 1880s. There was a Miss Margaret Fryer, who I know nothing about, except she taught this methodology for 2 years in the YMCA rooms in Brisbane and then just vanished. There was a Miss Ernell, who arrived in Brisbane and advertised that she was direct from London, trained in this particular system, and she would train women in Brisbane.
And so people would pay her to be trained, and that's how she
would pay.
Made a profit.
Yeah, okay. And then there was a Miss Harriet Lovelace, who was another one of these scientific dress cutters. But I think the best woman is Mrs. George. Now, Mrs. George was quite a progressive and well-known dressmaker in the city, and In the late 1880s, madames, it's very interesting because we had a group of madames in Brisbane too. There were about five of them, and I was always a bit worried about these women. They always gave themselves really fancy names, but they were really just Irish and Scottish women with these very fancy names. But Madame Arnold from Sydney had developed her own pattern-making system, and she was offering licences for women in Brisbane to take these up. She would train them in her method, and then they could then teach this method and make a lot of money. And this Mrs. George, she was a bit like Janet Walker. She was a really good businesswoman. She was charging a guinea a quarter for students to come and learn this methodology. Now, what this was about, and I know there are some fashion people in the audience, basically, when you trained as a dressmaker, you learnt the draping method where you would drape the lining on a body, and then Janet Walker eventually developed a mannequin to your body shape, and then she would just drape it onto that. And then you would cut the garment out. But with the scientific pattern cutting methodology, you actually had to take measurements. And then you would plot these measurements on paper. And sometimes you would only use measurements, and then it was all according to proportion. So you'd use the bust measurement, and the bust measurement was then quartered to get chest widths and all sorts of other widths, and you'd add inches to it or subtract inches. So it was all sort of done based on proportion.
Is that more complicated than it needed to be?
Oh, yes. But, you know, the men invented this. This was all based on... It's all based on maths. And it was all based on arcs, because if you look at the way they did the armholes, if you look at a modern armhole is sort of a U-shape. And the freer the garment or the looser the garment, the bigger the U gets. But in period garments, it's all circles. And what that did is it made the armhole extremely tight, and you could only drink cups of tea in your sleeve. You couldn't do the house cleaning. Of course, there were tea gowns and house gowns that did have looser sleeves, but it was a mathematical system of obtaining the bodice, the sleeves and the skirts, and then you... Then they would do wedding gowns, and I mean, it became a really big movement and very big business. And the number of books that were published in America and in England, not so many in Australia. I have done a search of what's available in Australia, and there are a few, and there are a couple of Australian produced ones in the National Library. But this suddenly sneaked in, and you know, the traditional dressmakers either had to learn this method or slowly, you know, disappear, because by drafting the pattern, you could do it much faster.
So this was the Industrial Revolution, and they were applying science to it. So it was all just evolving, and people writing books and trying to jump ahead of the science and sell a method. But then it would have all just taken off, and everybody would have had access to pattern making. Would they?
When they started the it was known as the dress making course, and this is the beautiful history of fashion education in Brisbane, because people don't link back to this course, and we spoke about this sort of lineage. In 1889, I think it was, the first dressmaking course was established at the Central Technical College, and they appointed a woman by the name of Mrs. Dixon, who I know nothing about except that she was the first TAFE teacher or technical teacher who taught the scientific cutting methodology at the technical school. And in 1892, Miss Margaret McCloy, who was a high-class dressmaker in the city, great opposition to Janet Walker. She had a lot of the high-class clientele. The important families of Brisbane went to her as well. She became one of the examiners of the students. The other woman who really made a name for herself in Brisbane and was probably the first dressmaker in Brisbane to use French construction methods was Margaret Scott. And she had opened her store in the 1870s, and quite a lot of the well-known weddings were done by Margaret. And it's wonderful to know that there are a couple of her garments still in existence, but they're in the NGV in Melbourne, not here in Queensland. They were shown in 2009 at the Museum of Brisbane exhibition in fashion. But she was a very innovative, and the lady journalist at that time loved Margaret Scott, and she'd always go into her store and look at the clothes that were being made, the trousseaus, the wedding gowns, and write these wonderful sort of reports.
Well, we still have the tradition, though, don't we, of people making dresses, especially for special occasions.
Yes, that has survived.
So for proms and for weddings, and Claire, so that's still an industry that's going. Is that in danger, do you think? Do you think there's enough innovation there?
No, I think that there's enough of the need, especially wedding dresses. It's the biggest in part of the fashion industry that's still alive in Brisbane, that, you know, there's wedding dress designers who are making the garments specifically to fit one person.
That's right. So there is a niche for dresses to be made to fit. But we did have this amazing revolution, and then department stores would have started buying in items of clothing that you could buy off the shelf.
Well, not initially.
No. When did that come in, though?
Well, again, you've got to go back and look at the history of the department store in Brisbane. And when, the name that you'd know well is Finney Isles and Co. And their first department store was this tiny, like, three little room store in the valley. That's where they started. And it wasn't until much, much later that Thomas Finney moved into the city and built those amazing stores that he built. And, of course, the big block still stands next door to the new David Jones Centre. But they all the department stores, and at the peak of department stores in Brisbane, there were over 100. Not many of them were run, very few run by women, mostly run by men. But there were only a handful of these really enormous department stores like Finney and Isles, Allen and Stark, Chapman and Company, Sinclair, Duncan Sinclair and Company, that was another big one. There was only a handful of those really large ones. Most of the others were quite small. But they all had dressmaking departments, tailoring departments. The larger ones had underwear departments and millinery departments, where they employed women and men in the tailoring departments to hand make. They were still hand making these garments. But of course, with the Industrial Revolution and mechanisation and the advent of steam, you know, we then started to see a lot more clothes being mass produced off the rack. Again, with the department stores, it was underclothing and men's shirting. But eventually we had the mass production of suiting. There was a company by the name of Stewart and Company. They had a big workroom where they employed women to mass produce men's suits. And you could buy some off the rack suits, but, you know, if you were someone of note, you would go to one of the tailors, because there was a huge tailoring fraternity in Brisbane as well.
And then we had the department stores coming in, presumably the role of the dressmaker started to decrease. But there still would have been designers in the 20s, would have been a big demand.
Yes, but we have to go back again. Because you've always got to go back, because there was always someone being innovative and challenging what the men were doing. And, of course, that was Janet Walker.
Okay.
In the 1890s, Janet Walker set up the first ladies' emporium in the city. Now, this was something that was totally unheard of before, where she combined dressmaking with millinery, and she also had parasols. And her milliner became her business partner eventually, Margaret Caldwell. And Margaret was importing French millinery and parasols. But what you could do then, it was all the one stop. You would go in. It's a bit like going to someone like Paul Hunt today. You go in, you choose the fabric, you discuss the design, you then go to your milliner, and you may take some of the fabric to the milliner as well, and she does a hat that complements. You buy a parasol that complements. Janet Walker stocked silk gloves, silk stockings, beautiful silk underwear, but you could have custom-made underwear as well. So it was this sort of one-stop shop now for women, and in a way it was very safe to go to that sort of place. It was also safe to go to a department store. That's why department stores did really well, because there were all these floor walkers in department stores. And, you know, Victorian women were very protected. But these department stores offered all these sort of areas of protection. They were, you know, Finney and Oz had a cafe, so these women could go to the tea rooms and have cups of tea with other women. So it was a very safe environment. And of course, Janet Walker offered that same sort of service. There were beautiful, you know, sofas in her workrooms now where you could sit and relax. The girls would bring you in a cup of tea, and it was a whole different ball game. And she was the only one that really did this. There were no other big emporiums run by women that offered the total service like Janet Walker. But unfortunately, Janet Walker developed cataracts in 1900, and she decided, and the lease on the building was in Upper Adelaide Street, the lease had come up and the cataracts were being really difficult, so she decided, need an operation, and apparently she went to St Helens and had the operation, and she decided she would not renew the lease for the whole emporium. She renewed the lease for one of the dressmaking areas, and continued. She went back to sort of more custom-made. There was none of this mass production of certain items as well. And the other thing that she did that no other Brisbane dressmaker did that I know of at that time is that she established a store in Sydney.
Right. So there is a tradition of Queensland dressmakers branching out to other states.
She's the only one I know of.
Well, but yeah. Then we have, of course, we jump well ahead. We're skipping vast amounts of time here back to into the 50s. Well, we've talked about Gwen Gillam a bit, but then we get up to Paula Stafford, who's really interesting, and we're going to run out of time to talk about all these people. But Paula was, of course, very famous on the Gold Coast. She was, Madeleine King and Nadia Buick are here, and they're this year's Business Leaders Hall of Fame Fellowship winners at the John Oxley Library, and they've been going through the fashion archives here looking, researching their project. We talked before about a number of dressmakers who really don't have the standing that they should have in history in Australia. Madeleine and Nutty, where are you? There you are. What are there other names? I mean, other names that span the period, say, from 1900 to the 1950s that should be better known?
I think a lot of those people are not necessarily just designers, but we've sort of been talking about department stores.
Yes.
Businesses, so a lot of the people like George Baggett, Embroiders, Finney Isle and Co. But when you get a bit further along, when you're talking about people like Paula Stafford, Olive Ashworth, are sort of big names. You know, Paula Stafford recognition, but we still sort of feel like there's quite a bit of work to do to really explore what all of those innovations were.
Mm. And that was a really long-running, successful, you know, design business and extremely innovative in terms of those kind of wonderful scientific, rational, you know, industrial kind of innovations. They were really pioneering, and that was, the history of the company is kind of a bit of a messy family history, but it's primarily run by a woman, Sarah Jenyns, and her story is quite fascinating. But that was running
late 19th century to the late 20th century, so yeah. Basically almost 100 years.
It is close to that, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes, so that's a really interesting collection. If you have a look over there, you'll see there's a list of body shapes, and you know, she's sort of famously made a corset to suit each body shape. Shape was always very important, of course.
What was really innovative about them too is that they took out patents for their designs, which very few women involved in this industry did. Janet Walker had two, but again, she's, in addition to Sarah Jenyns, Janet and Sarah were the only two women that I've come across that actually had registered patents for their designs. Checking
minor adjustments to their former patents, so it seemed like that was a real
Well, they were very well aware of it, weren't they? Because he was an instrument maker, and he would have known very well how important patents are, and they, yeah.
That's right, in that scientific kind of
world. That's right. Yeah. Now, Paula Stafford, I do want to talk about her a bit. I mean, if we're talking about innovation, adaption to Queensland's climate, and I suppose drawing on Queensland's, I suppose, you know, the unique things about Queensland, Paula Stafford really drew, didn't she, on the colours and the vibrancy of Queensland, and that really worked for her. She became very, very successful because of that and with her bikinis. Yeah. What is a reversible bikini, by the way? I should know.
Side out, and it's a different pattern on the other side. So you know, you've got a bit of novelty there. You could wear your different coloured top and bottom at the same time.
I didn't know that. You see, I could have worked it out.
The bikini. So she was really well known for that reversible kind of novelty thing.
But she was also a designer. She didn't just design bikinis.
She did garments as well. So she did a lot of kind of auxiliary. Sort of resort wear garments, so, you know, jackets, yeah. Blouses, capri pants, and a lot of those were reversible too. So we've looked at pieces, the Gold Coast Hinterland and Historical Society has quite a large collection, and they've got sort of full outfit where it's the bikini, the capri pants, and then a little capelet that's reversible, and they're all in kind of intermatching fabric. So that was a real kind of flourish.
Yes. Terry Towling.
she really promoted the pool dress as well. Mm. Yeah.
And once you get a name, too, you can start charging a lot of money. Mm. And Sammy Davis Jr. famously had a suit made.
Right,
Chrissy, do we have the pattern? We've got Sammy Davis Jr.'s suit pattern over there if you want to DNA test it or something. We could recreate him and make a suit for him as well. So that only and shows she would have made a fair bit of money. And then, of course, you know, to the current period, we've got Sass and Bide, who sort of, I suppose, we could claim them. Maybe. At a stretch. No. Mm. Lorna Jane, yeah. Of course. Yeah, so Claire, there are opportunities, aren't there? And if you can tap into them. We were talking earlier about there is a trend now towards locally made, isn't there? Mm-hmm. A lot of people, you'll see markets now, people do want to know where their food comes from, whether it's local or not. That's really important to us. Are you finding that in design as well, Claire?
Definitely. It's how my business is working. People want to know who makes it, where it's made, how it's made. They're becoming a lot more conscious of what products they either eat, wear, use. There's a whole resurgence of that locally produced, locally designed, locally made, whether that local be Brisbane or Australia. They just want to know that story. They want things with stories behind it. They want to be able to say, I met the girl who made this, you know, she's from such and such, she's been doing it for this long. And I think, I mean, at the moment I'm producing homewares, so I find a lot of people buy my products as gifts. So it's that extra thing that they can give to the recipient, to that story, that, you know, the whole feeling of the products. Coming back to that,
the pride in localism,
yeah,
isn't there?
And
community, because we've lost a bit of community, haven't we? And because of, for many reasons, but there's a sense of community in having things made locally and grown locally, food. You do get a sense that this is us, this is what, you know, our community, the people we know produce. It's a bit insular, but it actually is quite nice as well. And if we can do that, is there a market, do you think? Because there's a lot of concern really about imported you know, sweatshops in Bangladesh. We are worried about global warming. We, you know, the miles that clothes and food travel. Surely there's a market to tap into here.
Oh, definitely. I mean, it's quite big at the moment and it can only hopefully grow. Hopefully it doesn't decline, but I think it's definitely the trend is getting bigger and more people are becoming aware of, you know, all those things that, you know, people, you know, the factory accidents overseas, and then they start to question, they look at their labels going, where is my top made? Is it, you know, am I associated with any of these things that are happening? And they're just starting to ask the right questions, I guess. Yeah.
And we're mixing up fashions a bit as well, and you're wearing 50s, apparently.
Well,
but what if you had a period, if you had a period where you could go back in time and see a designer operating in their era, and you could walk around their shop, where would you go? Who would you see?
Oh, I don't know.
50s?
That's a tough question. Yeah, I love the 50s or the 20s.
So the 20s
as well, yeah.
20s is a bit of a mystery, is it?
The glam and
the glam is very glamorous. Michael, but which is your obviously late 19th century by the sound of it?
Janet Walker. Yeah, the 1880s are really quite beautiful. Turn of the century was quite beautiful, but my favourite period is the 60s. You know, as a contemporary period. I mean, my favourite historic period is Elizabethan because I just think that's when the glam was, you know, at its extreme, and the dressmakers were doing really well. But the 60s, I think, was a really, really innovative period, I think, for fashion. And I wish I was much older in the 60s to have enjoyed it more, because I remember my sister being glammed up in all these 60s frocks, and I would just look up at her. But, the 60s is my period.
If we if we could put our finger on a designer in Brisbane at the moment, apart from Claire, of course. Are there names that stand out at the moment that might have carried all that history through? Anybody think of them?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, the wedding. You know, there are lots of wedding designers in Brisbane that obviously look to the past for their inspiration. I mean, if you look at Brad Webb, who operates under the label Darb Couture. I mean, when he first came to the Brisbane scene, he designed a very, you know, sort of 18th century gown. That's what it looked like. You know, and he has maintained that skirt shape all these years because people just adore it. And a lot of Brad's garments do have that historical, you know, influence.
Have we run out of ideas? Are we ever going to see the 50s and 60s, that fresh new look,
well,
come back that we can
identify? I think the 60s are sort of roaming around the corner at the moment because, you know, with all the men's suits, you know, the lapels are really narrow at the moment. The trousers are back to the stovepipes and you've got to be very lean and mean and trim to wear those.
But have we run out of ideas? I mean, I think of maybe movies. You know, it's just the same theme now,
but
with different characters.
Yeah,
often.
What we do though is we might, you know, go back to the 60s and look at the silhouettes, but we are in, you know, the 21st century, so we're using, you know, contemporary textiles which they didn't have in the 60s.
Yes.
We're using technology like digital printing, which they didn't have in the 60s. The machinery now that workrooms use are so sophisticated, they didn't have that in the 60s either. You know, some hand embellishing now can be done by machine. I mean, they've got beading machines now. So, you know, we may, you know, go back and pick up on the silhouette, but what we then, you know, deliver to the public, I think, has been tweaked. And it's just, it's got that new freshness to it. Dye technology is so much better now. I mean, the palette that designers have got to play with today is phenomenal. Whereas, you know, in the past, I mean, they were using vegetable dyes and then eventually they discovered the, you know, the dyes made from coal byproducts and petroleum products. So it's the technology which is, you know, pushing you know, the industry forward, I think, and designers can use that technology and the fabrics that are being produced all over the world to create these.
In the 50s and 60s, and hot modernism's here, so, and we've talked about that, but there was a sense of being modern or even a step into the future and imagining how we might dress in the future and adopting that image to the fashions now. I'm watching some science fiction TV shows recently. I noticed that they'd imagined how people would dress in the future, but I'm not sure whether we're not adopting that. We're looking to the past.
Well, a lot of those really innovative designs are always catwalked, you know, at the big parades all over the world. Some of those garments don't necessarily end up in stores. You know, they really catwalk pieces to show the talent and the creativity of the design house. A lot of those gowns end up in museum collections, or they become part of the designer's own archives. But, you know, you do still see that innovation at the catwalks if you don't actually see it in the stores. But then, of course, with the, you know, with globalisation and the internet, it's very quick now for people to, you know, copy, which is a bit sad, but...
Yes, we were talking about that. Does anybody have any questions at all? Yes. Look, that's a really good question. And I think there is a vague crossover there. Surgical courses.
Well, when you go over and look at the surgical corsets, because we've got about 40 Jenyns surgical corsets in the collection at the museum, and we've had some of them out because the exhibition Undressed is opening at the museum in mid-November. It's a big underwear exhibition from the V&A, and the museum decided to show some of its underwear. And it's showing, quite interesting examples from the Jenyns to burlesque in Brisbane today to garments from the Hairy Dog collection, which was a design house in the Valley in the 80s, to Indigenous underwear. And we had to make, well, I was given the job of making the supports for these, and we were trying to work out, because they didn't want mannequins and they didn't want heads, and we were trying to work out exactly where these garments sat on the body. And you'll find most, but I could be wrong and I'll be corrected, but most of the surgical corsetry actually fits below the bust. When you look at modern corsetry or fashion corsetry, a lot of that sort of corsetry includes the bust, because you can do things to the bust like the Elizabethans did with their corsetry. You can squash the bust down. You can make the bust look bigger by padding that area. But with the surgical corsets, they were more interested in the back. You know, it was for lumbar support to help you with back problems or if you had problems after a pregnancy.
Was there also a sense that, look, I don't really need this. It's only because I have a medical condition.
Yeah, with kidney movement.
Was it an excuse, though, to have a surgical corset and say, well, I just need it?
You know, it was very big business.
I normally look like this anyway. It's just medical, for medical reasons.
I mean, there are contemporary corsets too that are designed to go below the waist because, you know, the dress that you wear over the top of that basically has been designed to take advantage of your free bust. So, you know, they have used that sort of medical approach as well in a more contemporary fashion.
Now, we've run out of time, but if you want to ask some more questions, you can. There's quite a bit to look at over there. You can see Sammy Davis Jr.'s suit pattern as well, and you can ask some questions when we have a wander around here for the next half hour if you've got some time. Please thank with me Clare Collyer and Michael Marendy. And yes, go and have a look. There's some amazing things. The corsets, especially, very interesting. Thank you.